Hello and welcome to Our Stories, His Glory. It's my honor to be here with you every other week now, not every week. And today I have a special guest. And yes, I say that every week, special guest, but it seems to always be true. Leslie Nease is my guest. And before I bring her in, you can see her on the screen now, but before, and she's waving. Before I let her speak, and she'll do most of the talking, I want to tell you about this person. Now, I can tell you that I know her a little bit, and our paths have crossed in the past, and you can look her up online. But she's got so many things she's done in her life and so many things going on now. I don't know if she has time in the day. I don't know how she does to be able to speak to us here, but she does. So Leslie is a wife and a mother. She's an empty nest parent now, and I know back when we first met, she was busy raising them kids. And she currently is doing co-hosting a Facebook, I think it's on Facebook, podcast with her sister, Marie. And you got to see that. It's called Midlife Madness. And they pretty much just are off the cuff midlife madness kind of stuff. She's also a speaker. She's also a writer. She wrote the book, Living the Life You Were Created to Live. She's also been a Christian radio personality. For those who are in my area near Shelby, North Carolina, we could pick Leslie up back when she was on his radio, 89.3. And I remember listening to her then. She also provided me a quote in the book that I wrote several years ago, Top 10 Ways to Be a Man's Man in God's Eyes. So a little shameless plug there, even though it's not in publication anymore, I can still give you a copy. She's now a fitness coach. Above all else, the things that she does, she was Mrs. North Carolina in 2001. Mrs. North Carolina, I can't wait to ask her about that. And she lives in Ogden, Utah now. But most people are going to remember, and you can see from the graphic behind me, that she was my personal favorite contestant that's ever been on the show Survivor. And I am a true fan because my wife and I have never missed a season yet. And Leslie Nease is my contestant of all time, above Boston Rob, above Ozzy, above anybody else. Russell Hance, dead last. So we're going to ask her about that. And if those of you who are tuning in or because you know her from Survivor, she's fine with that. And we're gonna rehash that scene a little bit, that what I call the famous scene. But I could talk all day about Leslie, but I'm ready to shut up and let her talk. Leslie, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Of course. I am so excited. I was so excited to hear from you. It's been a while since we've even chatted, and I've always just adored you. So this is super fun.
Well, thank you. I know I used to send my column out, and I think occasionally you weekly, and you've commented on it a couple of times, and I appreciate that. But for whatever reason, in the last few years, I don't get on Facebook as much to stalk people as just to post something. So it took me a little bit to kind of reconnect, and we did, and you graciously agreed to appear on this thing I'm doing.
Our story. I love it. Well, it's thank awesome. You.
I appreciate that. Well, let's start with the obvious. Let's go to Survivor. Survivor China. Remind me again what year that was.
It was in 2007.
Time flies.
14 years ago.
My goodness, time flies.
I know.
So you were on Survivor China. Now, you came to speak at Gardner-Webb when I was the baseball coach at Gardner-Webb and spoke to the student body, the entire student body, and you showed your audition tape for Survivor. And if I'm right, it was some kind of rap video or something.
Oh, yeah. Well, the one that they actually picked me from was taken at the radio station I worked at the time. But I think I just did the rap for your students because kids love that. They love it. And I did actually one of my videos. I auditioned 11 times before I was picked. Wow. So one of those videos, I did a rap with my kids. And so I always perform that when I'm with younger people because they love it.
That's what it was. You performed the rap there in the middle, right there at half court of the basketball arena in front of the whole student body. So what I'm going to do in a minute is I want to replay this scene that people who are Survivor fans will remember. And for those who don't know much about Survivor or anything about Survivor, they're still will hopefully be able to appreciate this. So what we're going to do is go back to Survivor China 2007. And I believe, and I'm going to let you fill me in on this. I believe that, that these happened at near the very beginning of the season.
Yeah, we hadn't even really started yet. It was just a welcome ceremony because it was a really, really big deal that we were in China. And I remember Mark Burnett, the creator of Survivor and the executive producer at the time, he was very, he was giddy about being in China. And so they had this huge welcome ceremony before the game even started, before we were even divided into tribes. And that's what you're going to witness. So the game hadn't even started yet.
Okay. Well, that makes sense to me more now because I've heard you say before they actually had alternates kind of waiting in the wings in case somebody misbehaved.
Well, they told us very, very sternly before this, before it all started, if you offend the Chinese culture in any way, we will take you out of the game and put your alternate in and we won't even bat an eye. And of course, you know, I'm sure the alternates were foaming at the mouth wanting to
somebody misbehave.
They were like, ooh, I hope they mess up, you know? So,
well, I'm going to show it now. And then with your permission, I'm going to show it all the way through and then kind of go back and pause it at what I think are some important points. So let's watch together and let people kind of relive this with us. Okay. Wow. What is it like to, I know you've seen that over and over and you've showed it, you know, probably when you went to speak. What's it like to see that again?
I just, you know, it's very emotional to me because it was such a defining moment in my faith and in my life. I think we all have those moments where we look back and go, okay, that one really was impactful. And this particular moment in my life, I had auditioned to be on Survivor 11 times. So for 5.5 years, every 6 months, I made an audition video and sent it in with a 12-page application and tried to get on this show. I really felt like it was something I was supposed to do.
Yeah.
And I never got a call. I never got anything until then. And then when they called me, it was like I knew that I was going to be on it. I even told the casting people, I'm like, I need to just go ahead and pack my bags because I know you're going to pick me for this. And I think probably my faith and my, my attitude, you know, just of like, I know this is what God has for me. Like you can't get in the way of that. You know, I think that made them go, okay, there's the crazy Christian lady. we're going to cast her. She's going to be really good TV.
And you were,
well, I mean, go figure.
We were glued to it. So I've paused it now. I'm going to pause it at two different places. And as I talked to you before we went on, this seems to me, and as I said, television production people can manipulate pictures, but it looks to me like what's happened here is very real, that you are actually looking at whatever was the idol or what, and making a decision mm-hmm. that would ultimately affect the rest of your life. And you were going through I don't want to call it a huge dilemma because I know where you ended up with it, but that this was maybe mentally agonizing for you because you're realizing all that. Is that what's happening in this picture?
Well, I mean, a couple, I don't even want to say a couple, a thousand things were running through my mind the whole time. I was praying under my breath the entire time, Lord, I don't know what's going on in this temple. And they don't show it, but I mean, we were in that temple for like an hour and a half, doing different things and going in different rooms and all this stuff. And I was just there just praying and just like, Lord, if I cross a line, you're going to have to let me know because I don't know what any of this means. You know, they were chanting, they were lighting incense. There was all this stuff going on. And I was sad because I felt like they were putting me in an impossible situation.
Yeah.
I felt like if I did cross the line, which I just knew there was going to be a line at some point. I knew it. And I think I was afraid. I'm going to be honest. It was a very hard thing for me because I finally got on this show that I auditioned for 11 times. I finally am living my dream. And I thought it was going to get taken away from me because, you know, in my opinion, if you walk out of a service, people might get offended.
Yeah,
and exactly. They said, if you offend somebody, we're going to take you out and put your alternate in. And so my dilemma was actually an answer to a prayer that I had before I even went on the show. And the prayer, I don't know, Rusty, have you ever wanted something just so badly and you knew it was God, but then you're like, what if it's not? Yeah. What if I want more than I want God? What if I want to be on Survivor more than I want to be with God? Like, is this dream bigger than you? Please don't let it be bigger than you. I begged, like, you've got to stop me. Don't let me do this if this means more to me than you.
Yes.
And so in a sense, he answered that prayer. He let that part of my heart go. Like, I was able to let that go and just recognize that that moment was a defining moment of me saying, this game doesn't mean as much to me as my faith in God.
Right.
So it was incredibly emotional for me. Yeah.
I can tell. I mean, the facial expression, and again, I don't want to exploit the pictures, but if you just look at what you're going through here, that had to be really tough. So now I'm going to go a little bit further forward. And we talked about this a little bit and you gave me permission to mention it. So you get outside, Jeff Probst is going to not necessarily call you out, but he wants to discuss it.
Oh no, he called me out.
He called you out. And as you begin to explain, we just saw in the video, we get this picture of Courtney, and I'm about to get to it. At the 1 minute mark, and you're explaining, and there she, I guess I could stop this pretty much anywhere.
Yes.
Do you know if that was edited in or she really did turn and give you that look at that moment, or is that just producers trying to create some drama?
Well, it's funny because as the show progressed, she and I got incredibly close.
Yes.
Like very, very close. And she called me the night that this aired, as soon as it showed. And she goes, Mama, because she called me Mama. Yeah. She's like, Mama, I did not make that look for you. She said, I made it for John Robert.
Yeah, okay.
Because what they didn't show, and this is how reality TV is, they show what they want. I wasn't the only person who walked out.
Wow.
And Jeff actually asked John Robert first. He said, John Robert, why did you walk out? And John Robert just said, I don't know. It just felt silly. I'm not religious. That's all he said. And when he said it, we were all looking at John Robert, and Courtney looked over at me and rolled her eyes like, what kind of answer is that? And then they made it look like she was doing it to me, which
isn't
is hilarious.
Because how they manipulate.
I was like, no, I remember you looking at me like that. Like, I remember thinking, oh, great, what's she going to think about what he's going to say about me now, you know? But she actually really respected what I did because it had a purpose behind it. And I want to add, the reason that I said I'm not religious was because that's what John Robert said. He goes, I don't know. I felt weird. It was, I'm just not religious. And he said, Leslie, what about you? I said, I'm not religious either. Right. But I do have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And they edited out the part where I said either. And they made it sound like I was just dropping this this truth in the middle of nowhere for no reason, which is hilarious because God opened so many doors for me to share the difference between religion and relationship with people because of that. So, I mean, of course, God can use everything for his good. And that's what he did.
That's incredible. And I did know afterwards from some of the things you had said and some of your things online that you and Courtney have remained close and she calls you mama. Some of them began to call you Sister Christian.
Yeah.
And obviously we know the song from our days back in, I think it was 1987 or so. Mm-hmm. It seems to me though, that you, for whatever reason they started that, you wore that as a badge of honor. You kind of went with it. So tell me about that a little bit.
Well, I think that, you know, when you go on Survivor, you know that they can edit you to look any way that they want. And it kind of encouraged my heart a little bit that's what they were showing me as. Like I could tell that was the character, quote unquote, that they wanted me to play. I didn't act any way. I was just myself, but they took out the moments, you know, where I talked about the Lord. And, you know, if you think back, Rusty, to when the word Christian was actually first spoken, it was a derogatory term for Christ followers. Yeah. The word Christian isn't even in the Bible. It was something that they called people who followed Christ, and it was an insult, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. But they took it as a badge and started calling themselves that. And I thought, they're calling me something that they think is derogatory, but like there is nothing I would rather be identified with than Jesus Christ. So, okay.
And then my hope during all that, as we go back here, my hope was, wow, I want this Leslie Nease, I've never heard of you till then. I want her to go all the way and win the whole thing because Lord, the kingdom would really get a lot of attention if she won and was able to use that platform and that podium, so to speak, to share her faith. But it wasn't meant to be.
Rusty, I knew before I went, he gave me, I don't know, it wasn't like words or anything. I had a feeling that winning the million wasn't why he wanted me there.
Right.
Okay. Now I wanted to win the million, but I knew that wasn't God's purpose for me. So it kind of freed me up to not be obsessed with like, you know, the money and more like just taking one day at a time and saying, God, use me, God, use me, God, use me, however that looks, use me. And just kind of enjoying my moments out there without all of that pressure of feeling like, oh, I have to win. I wanted to win, of course. I mean, you're going to give up 2 months of your life. Of course, you'd like to come back with $1 million for it. But I feel like I came back with so much more.
That's fantastic because now we're still talking about it.
I mean, 14 years later. Yeah. And I still get, I mean, there's, you know, because of the pandemic, people have been watching all the seasons again because they're not filming Survivor right now. And I'm not kidding, probably once a week, some kind of Facebook message or email or something from somebody saying, I just watched your season for the first time. And I just want to say thank you so much for representing Jesus Christ the way you did. And I'm just blown away by that. I'm just blown away by it.
That's fantastic because, and I'll give you what I believe is even more proof of that is when they did the season where they had all the previous winners, we're avid fans and I didn't recognize some of those people. I had to kind of think back like, wait a minute. But I remember Leslie Nease and I remember exactly what happened, you know, at Survivor China, but there's some people we kind of had to remind ourselves. Yeah, I guess that person did win that season. So God used it more by you not winning than
he used it in a, like God's ways are not our ways. And I think people look at, oh, you failed at Survivor because you were voted out on day 9. You know, people look at that and go, you failed. You didn't win. It's like, God says, no. She won because she obeyed my voice.
Yes,
she listened to what I asked her to do and she showed up.
So it's a matter of perspective.
I'm more concerned. Actually, Galatians 1:10 is like one of my life verses. And it said, am I here to please people or am I here to please Christ? If I'm here to please people, then I can't please Christ. It's about pleasing him. And a lot of times that means people aren't going to be pleased with you. And that's okay. I'm okay with that. Like, I don't get hung up on that because my identity is in him, not in other people.
So if we were to stop right now, we would already have our lesson for the day, Galatians 1:10. But I don't want to stop because this is really good, and we will continue on. There's, by the way, another factor, what you got a parasite, and people don't really know a whole lot about that. And it kind of, I can see where that can happen. You're in that survival situation.
And to be honest, China was just, we were in a very, very remote area in China. I am pretty certain that I got the parasite before we were even put into the game. Because we were there for almost 2 weeks. We had to do press interviews. We had a bunch of traveling to do. We had to go. I mean, we were there for a long time and we weren't able to talk to each other or form relationships. Right. They wouldn't let us do that, but they definitely, you know, we were there and we were eating the food. We were drinking the water. I'm pretty sure that I got it even before the game started. And, because I wasn't feeling good the day that we, were released. I told them, I said, I kind of have a stomach ache. I said, and I remember saying, if I have appendicitis, are you guys going to be able to save me? Like, what's going on here? They're like, oh, you'll be fine. Don't worry about it. I was like, okay. So, you know, and I didn't want to not play. So I was like, I'll just go in. It'll go away. It's maybe just a tummy virus. I didn't know, but it kept getting worse and it zapped my energy. And I often say, like, if you can have a regret about anything that you've ever done, my regret is that I got a parasite because I feel like it really took a lot of my energy, my excitement from the game. When I remember doing challenges and feeling like, have you ever had a dream where you're trying to run and your body won't work?
Almost every night.
Yes. Okay. Well, that was my reality. I remember thinking, oh my gosh, this feels like my dream.
Yeah.
Where I'm trying to run and my body, I literally had zero left. I mean, in 9 days, I lost 17 pounds. I was so sick. And I honestly believe, and I believe I told your kids this at Gardner Webb when I spoke, that man's rejection is God's protection, because when they voted me out, I had to be treated
immediately.
By physicians. And they were so, let me just say, CBS took such good care of me and did such a good job of getting me healthy again. You know, I've had issues since then, but it hasn't been as bad, I think, as if they wouldn't have taken such good care of me.
Well, good. That's good to hear. And a question that I really want to ask, and I think people would love to hear. What if you had gone through with the ceremony? What if you had, quote, bowed down to the idol? And I don't like to talk hypothetical.
No. But I think it's actually a really good question because what people don't realize, and maybe they do if they know the game pretty well or know the show pretty well, there were three other Christians or self-proclaimed Christians on my season. Now, they were on the other tribe. Yeah. But they were Christians and, they bowed, and I have zero judgment for that because they all three told me, we just prayed to Jesus the whole time. You know what I mean? He's more concerned about the heart. And listen, I get that. I really do. And I tried to do that. But I had a thought, and this is going to sound funny, but like me bowing and praying to the Lord, it just felt like I would be making out with some other man and telling my husband, well, honey, it's okay. I was thinking about you the whole time.
Oh, wow. What an analogy.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
And I just was like, I couldn't do it. Now, if somebody else did, that's between them and God. I have zero judgment. But for me personally, where I was in my walk with the Lord at that moment, I could never have done it. There was zero question about it. And if I would have done it, I know I could have played probably longer. I could have done probably well in the world's eyes in the game. But in spiritual terms, I think it would have been incredibly difficult for me. And I think it would have been a very hard thing to get over just because of my convictions. And I'm a big stickler. I don't know if you realize this, but like when you get a conviction from God and you ignore it and you just ignore it and you keep ignoring, eventually he stops. He's just like, she's not going to listen. You're like, you can't hear it anymore.
You've got a hardened heart at that point.
Yes. And I don't want that to happen to me. I don't want that to be my reality. And so listening to him, every time you do listen, you get a little more tender and a little more soft-hearted and you can hear his voice. And Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27, that's where the Lord says, I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to take out your old stony, stubborn heart. Hello, I have one of those. And I'm going to replace it with a heart of flesh that will be tender and yep. responsive to my voice. And I'm going to put my spirit in you so that you can follow my decrees. And I think that that's, for me, having surrendered my life to the Lord really in 2003. So I had only been a true believer for about 4 years mm-hmm. when this happened. And you know how they say who much is forgiven, you know, there's just this appreciation. Like I feel like because I knew what it was like to live a life of trying and trying and trying, and I finally just, instead of trying, I was dying to myself and letting him live through me. I feel like that was my offering to him. And it was just a really powerful, I would do it again and again. I don't know that I wouldn't have done it. But if I wouldn't have, I can tell you right now, there is no miserable like a Christian who's disobeying God miserable.
Wow. I want to say this with all due respect. Preach it, Sister Christian. Yeah. because you've made some, I hope people are going to watch this later and pause it and write the verses down and the mm-hmm. truths down. And I'm doing some pastoral supply now, and I've already got 3 or 4 sermon ideas.
Yes, that's what it's about, my friend.
So I want to lighten it up a minute before we leave Survivor. And I asked you for permission to do a couple of my Jeff Probst impressions.
Yes.
So now that we have the public eye here, at least all your Facebook fans and friends, they're stuck. They're going to have to listen to me. I'm going to kind of go in order here and start at the beginning of the show. These are some things that Jeff Probst says, and here's what it is. Previously on Survivor.
Okay? Oh my gosh, you sound just like him.
Well, thank you.
I'm going to close my eyes. I just want to close my eyes. I want to hear it again. Do something else.
Okay, this one's leading up to a challenge. Come on in, guys.
Yes.
Says it every time. He tells them he has to invite them in. They don't know how to get there. He has to tell them to come on in. All right. The third thing is after they lose a challenge. Mm. Blue tribe, got nothing for you. Head back to camp.
Yes.
Get the tribal council for number 4. It is time to vote.
Yes.
Then somebody gets voted out. I'm going to go Boston Rob. Mm. Boston Rob, the tribe has spoken.
Yes.
And then finally,
it's time for you to go.
Time for you to go. I almost added that, but I
forgot that
every single time. And so I should have added that. And then finally, the easiest one is next time on Survivor.
Yes. Oh my goodness. You sound just like him.
Well, you're so telling funny. That because I know you get to go to the reunion stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Take his job. When actually, I don't want his job.
No.
He's doing quite well without me. So, okay. So Survivor kind of going to the side for a moment because there's much more to Leslie Nease than just Survivor, as we've talked about. So I want to hear, I don't want to spend too much time because I got some other things I want to get to, but tell me about Mrs. North Carolina 2001.
Okay, so it's kind of funny, and you may actually find this humorous. I'm not like a pageant person. Like I've done pageants, usually because I wanted to get back in shape, and I thought, well, there's a way to you know, feel like you have to really work because you're gonna be on stage in front of people. You know what yeah. I mean? Like you've got to be working hard. I've always worked really hard. I do well with a goal. And so I had just had my daughter in the year or August of 2000. And I was struggling with losing some of the baby weight. And I was like, I'll just do another pageant. So I signed up and auditioned to be in the Mrs. North Carolina pageant. And with they're planning the pageant, everything is going well. And all of a sudden the pageant director, she quit. She just quit. And so the headquarters in New York decided to take all of the contestants and do a, I call it a mail-in or mail order Mrs. North Carolina pageant, which was basically they did, you know, interviews on the phone. We had to do some, you know, essays, different things like that. Just, and they judged us from their home base in New York. There wasn't an actual pageant. And I ended up winning, which is hilarious because, like, I don't think I would have won if we would have been on stage. And, but it did give me an opportunity to go to the Mrs. United States pageant in Las Vegas. And it's funny because when I was there, I had been watching Survivor, since it started in 2000.
Yep.
There was a friend of mine named Laurette who I had done pageants with before. She was in the Mrs. United States pageant with me. And we were sitting on the bus going to an event and she represented, I don't remember which state, but she said, she goes, yeah, I auditioned for Survivor. And I was like, what? You did what? Why would you do that? She goes, oh my gosh, it's such a cool show. Have you seen it? I'm like, yeah, it's stupid. Why would people do that on purpose? You know, like, why would you go and do it? And she, it was the first time that I just even for a second thought, well, that would be cool. And then it was, you know, a year later when I started auditioning.
Mrs. North Carolina, I'm, regardless of you thinking it was somewhat of a fluke, I'm going to be impressed.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. It was a really fun time. I got to, you know, travel around and talk to schools and different things about my platform was introducing children to physical fitness early to prevent obesity related issues in the future. And so that was my big platform. And I was able to do that a lot through North Carolina. Plus I've been a fitness instructor since 1993. It's been a while.
And you're doing that now, correct?
Yeah, I'm still doing it. Yeah.
Okay, good.
I always tell my classes, I think I've been teaching fitness longer than you've been alive. So.
and that's great because we're not going to talk age here, but we're not spring chickens.
No, I don't care. I'm 51 and I'm proud. I love it.
All right, 57 and I'm proud. I'm going to go play tennis twice a week. I still do that. So, but here's what I also want to ask you about on a little more serious note. And I did some reading this week as I was prepping on this. And I remember from your testimony, you know, when you came to Gardner Webb and some things, you mentioned that you and your husband actually were married for more than a decade, maybe about 13 years when you both came to a relationship with the Lord around 2003 and mm-hmm. surrendered your life.
Yeah.
What prompted that and what led up to that? What was like before that? You just tell us about that. Cause I think people always to preface that a lot of people believe that whatever you decisions you make in high school and college are kind of your life decisions spiritually.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that that's not always true. So tell us about your journey there.
Well, when I was about 10 years old, my mom and our stepfather and I, we all became Christians, but we were in a very, it was the kind of church that was all about rules and regulations.
Legalism.
And very much, very steeped in legalism. And I always, when I say I became a Christian, I really don't know that I did, because I was just afraid to go to hell. Mm-hmm. So I would basically go up and say the prayer that they would tell me to say every week. I mean, I'd run up there and do my thing. I was always at the altar. You know what I mean? Like,
right. Okay,
save me. Yeah. You know, I'm so scared. And, I was terrified of God. I thought he hated me. And then I made some really bad decisions through high school and college. And so I was just convinced that God had no use for me at this point. So I just kind of ran. My parents were in church. My dad was a Southern Baptist deacon at this point. And we had gotten away from that other church, but it was still kind of in the back of my mind. When you're raised in that, it's very hard to see God as loving and gracious, because all you see is it's the fear of God times infinity. You know, it's like the unhealthy fear instead of the healthy fear. And so, our oldest daughter, when she was about 4 years old, and I was very young. I mean, we only had the two kids at the time. We now have four. But she got chicken pox, and the flesh-eating bacteria got in through one of her open sores, and she went into septic shock, and we almost lost her. They told us she was probably going to die. And they brought a priest in. I hadn't been to church in years. And I remember they said, do you want the priest to pray for you? And I was like, no, I'm not even Catholic. Like, I'll just pray myself. And I prayed, and I said, it was such a sad prayer in retrospect. I'm like, oh, I wish I would have known who God really was. Mm-hmm. Instead of taking somebody's word for it, really search the scriptures for myself, because I assumed that God was going to take my daughter away from me because I was such a bad person,
right,
and that he was mad at me. And I remember saying, I was like, if you will let me keep her, I will dedicate her to you. I didn't want to dedicate me because I didn't think that was a good, I didn't think he'd care. I was like, he just wants her. Okay, fine. I'll send her to church. I'll do whatever. And so she did miraculously survive, which was literally, there were kids in the area that we lived that were passing away from this. It was really, really bad. And so I was like, well, now we have to take her to church.
So, yeah, you got to fulfill that promise. Like,
right, right.
Anna that did it with Samuel. Or
Samuel. So I did. I took her to church, and, you know, we would drop her off and then go pick her up. We didn't want to go. I didn't think God cared about me. I mean, I really, it was so sad. But the thing that happened is that my daughter really did love Jesus, and she developed a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And it was different than anything I'd ever seen. And I wanted what she had. So I went in to go back to church, to a different kind of church that was a little more my speed, that wasn't all about rules and was more about relationship. And that's, you know, at the time where I was seeking, my husband was seeking, all the things were just lining up until we went to go join a church that we really liked. We went to it was in Steel Creek Church of Charlotte with Kelvin Smith, who I absolutely love. And it was a discipleship class that you have to go to before you can become a member. And it was a Friday night, and we sat there, and he talked about what it means to truly surrender your life to Christ, not just be saved, but like, right, give your heart and your life, like literally what it means to believe. When it says, the Bible says to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. That word believe in the Greek is pisteo. And that means like a firm conviction, a full surrender, and your lifestyle can't help but reflect it. And I did like a little checkup, and I was like, okay, I don't have that. That's not who I am, but that's who I want to be. And so I said the prayer in my chair. I didn't get up. I couldn't move. Like, it was heavy. Like, the spirit of the Lord was so on me that I couldn't move. I could barely breathe because it was so real in that moment. And so then Kelvin said, if you said the prayer, raise your hand and stand up. My husband raised his hand, really? And stood up.
Wow.
God had been doing the same thing to him at the exact same moment. Mm-hmm. And then he was like, you know, and then everybody was clapping, and I couldn't move. I was stuck in my chair. So we get in the car, and my husband's like, I don't know what just happened. That was just so weird. I go, I did the same thing, honey, but I couldn't move. Do you think it's stuck? You know, am I okay? Like, and
did that thing take?
Yeah. Well, what was so funny though, is that he goes, in his literal babiness as a Christian, he said the most profound thing. He said, I guess we'll know in time. And the changes happened, and our lives, our decisions, our everything just changed in such a beautiful way that I knew it was real. And here's the funny thing, Russ, think about this. As a kid, forward, hand, stand, all the time. It never took. It was when I didn't do that. It was when I sat in my seat in humility and couldn't move. That was when it took. And I feel like it is such, I don't want to say I wasn't a Christian when I went forward and believed in Jesus, but honest to God, it never changed me the way it did when I was 33 years old, sitting in Steel Creek Church of Charlotte.
So God used some 46:10, be still.
Yeah.
And know that I'm God. Instead of all the rigmarole, he got to be still.
And that heaviness that I felt that night, it was the only time in my life I had ever felt it. And there was only one other time I felt it. And that was outside of the temple. Hmm. After I walked out, I felt it again. And if you watch it, you see me, I slide down the wall of this Buddhist temple because it was so heavy. And I was like, oh, there it is again. I mean, like, I just knew that God was pleased. I could feel his pleasure. And I don't know if that makes any sense, but
it makes perfect sense because I think a lot of people have not only been brought to their knees, but been brought to a screeching halt in their lives by the Spirit to get our attention, to shake us up.
Right. And I think that that was the key. I mean, and then the book that I wrote that you talked about is actually called Wholehearted, Living the Life That You Were Created to Live, is based on Ezekiel 36, 26, and 27. Okay. And I say I had a spiritual heart transplant. It was a literal, like Jesus took out my stony, stubborn heart and replaced it with a new heart that could hear him and could respond and could understand when I read the Bible. And it was just amazing. And what I did was I contacted a woman who had a physical heart transplant, and I took her physical heart transplant and my spiritual one, and I like compared the two.
Yep.
It's so similar. It's so crazy. You have to read this book. I promise I don't even make much money. It's self-published, whatever, but it's so powerful how God does that.
And that's called
Wholehearted.
Wholehearted and living the life you were created to live. Can people access that online?
You can go on Amazon. I mean, it's on Amazon. It's real cheap sometimes.
Okay.
And I'm actually thinking of doing an audio recording of it. You know, I've never done that, but I thought I've done radio and podcasts. I think I could probably read my book. I could probably read my book on audio.
On behalf of the rest of the world, we want you to do that because you do have a gift. I don't want to say a gift of gab. That's not.
No, but it makes sense. It was what I was always yelled at for when I was a kid. On every report card. Leslie talks too much.
Fruitful in your life. So the podcast with your sister, which I really enjoyed because y'all have some opposite tendencies in that she likes everything written down and detailed and you like to just go off the cuff.
Yes.
And it's called Midlife Madness. Now, when I tried to access, it's basically on Facebook, right?
Oh, no, it's everywhere. We're on all the podcasting streaming.
Okay.
But we're also, sometimes we'll do a live one, but sometimes, you know, I know how to edit and do all that too.
Yeah.
So if we really want to sound amazing, we try to edit. Otherwise, it's just two middle-aged women talking about life, you know. We start every podcast off with a segment we call I Can't Believe She Said That Out Loud. And it's always an embarrassing story of something
personal. I saw that. She was talking about the Thanksgiving turkey that she stuffed that was just the breast and it wasn't the turkey.
I mean, just embarrassing things that we do as women.
I started a podcast recently, as you're one of my readers from the past, Wacky Wednesday Wisdom, and I got mine put on where I read them, and I put it on Buzzsprout, but it goes to Spotify. Can people get to yours on Spotify?
We're on Spotify, Amazon, iTunes, really literally everything. It's funny. They come to us. They're like, hey, we want to put you on our pod. I'm like, all right, fine. You know, so whoever asks, I'll put you, you can have it. We're not making money.
Right.
I don't want it to be about that because then it won't be fun anymore.
Then it becomes a job.
Then it's a job. Yeah. So we just like, it's so much fun. The topics have been hilarious. We talk about growing up together. We talk about friendships. There's some really serious ones. My sister is a speaker for NAMI, which is the National Alliance for Mental Illness. Mm-hmm. And she's very, she knows a lot about that. I know a lot about fitness. We did one about my survivor experience. We've got different podcasts. We haven't done one in a little while. We've gotten to the point where we're like, when we feel like doing it, we'll do it.
That's
but don't
exactly,
make us do it every week.
That's why my wacky wisdom, somebody started telling me I was doing Wacky Wednesday Wisdom. It's a devotional, as you know. And they said, you need to rename that thing Wacky Every Other Wednesday.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah.
I feel like it.
I do it when I feel like it. When I was a columnist in the paper for those 9 years, I had a deadline every week.
And yeah.
You know, this, I don't have any deadline. If I don't want to do it,
if you're not making money on it, if you don't have sponsors, there's no pressure. And that's kind of why we're like, people have said, hey, can we sponsor? We're like, no, because we don't want to have to do it. We want to want to do it. I think there are some things in life you have to do, right? I get that. Like, I'm all about that. But you need to not do everything so that you can do the things that you have to do.
And so you get to choose a lot of things you want to do. The last thing I want to mention, and then we're gonna sign off here in a moment, but you're still part of that hashtag mom squad from Survivor. And I know you guys get together, but one of the stories is a little tough, and that's about one of your friends battling cancer. And I think you recently, y'all made a trek up to see her. Tell me about Sunday.
Sunday Berquist was on Millennial versus Gen X Survivor 33. Okay. And so we weren't on the same season, but I'm like a super big, I'm into community no matter where I go. I need to have community. I love getting people together. And so on Survivor, I actually created like a private Facebook group for past contestants where we can go and connect.
Yeah.
And within that, then the moms from each season, we now like have our own group called the Mom Squad, where it's every season you'll see there's a Leslie, there's, you know, there's a Sunday, there's a, you know, a Jill, there's, we're all basically the same person, like a mom who loves adventure and has a very type A personality. When we get together, everybody talks and like, we just wait to be the next one to talk. You know, it's hilarious. Yeah. We're just very communicative. We have so much fun together. And Sunday is a breast cancer survivor, but back in June of last year was diagnosed with esophageal and ovarian cancer. And so she's fighting for her life right now. We went to go see her, I guess a couple of months ago now it's been. And, you know, before we went, we were like, should we go? Like, you know, with COVID, it's like, what do we do? So we all like isolated ourselves, got tested, and then went and didn't do anything except be with her. Yeah. So it was a very safe time. Of course, some people saw it online and were like, how could you expose her? It's like, are you kidding me? Like, do you really think we would do that? Like, we love her. There's no way. But we went to go visit her and just had like, it was in November and we had like an early Christmas, and Sunday loves Christmas. So her house looks like it just threw up Christmas everywhere. I mean, it was magical. It was like being at the North Pole. I'm not kidding. And we had an amazing time, but I started a GoFundMe for Sunday because her expenses, I mean, every time you get chemo, it's $13,000.
Oh my goodness.
And so we started a GoFundMe for her. And I do a step out for Sunday, whatever Sunday you want, go take a walk, take a hike, go for a bike ride, roller skates. I don't care what you do, but go out and while you're doing it, pray for her and maybe consider making a donation for her GoFundMe. She's got a family and I know they could use the help. There's so many needs in the world right now. So it's like hard to say, but she needs it so bad. You know, it's like hard. But yeah, so all of that is on my Facebook page. If you want to,
that's what I was going to ask you. So we're going to post this interview on your Facebook page and mine. Yeah. And I have close to 4,000 Facebook friends too. Most of who I probably couldn't name, but you have a lot of fans. So hopefully that'll kind of get the word out too. And LeslieNease.com is a place they could actually contact you on that if they needed to.
Yeah, absolutely. My email is leslienease@gmail.com. You can contact me that way. And if you're on my website, you'll see I haven't blogged in a while. I don't know. I feel it's kind of one of those things where, again, I just, when I feel like blogging, I blog. And it hasn't been a lot lately. I've had so many other things that have been going on. Plus, it's been a really hard year for a lot of people. But I have I still do speaking engagements and retreats, which, by the way, retreats are my absolute favorite thing in the whole wide world. Okay. Next to my family and Jesus, you know, of course, but I love retreats because then you have the opportunity. It's not like, hey, here's a message. See you later. It's like, here's a message.
Yeah.
Let's wait. Let's now have dinner together and we'll talk more. And then you get up and you have another message. And then there's another message in the afternoon. And that, you know, so it's like a 3-day thing where you can really build relationships with people and really help connect each other. But because of COVID, haven't been able to do those either. But I do hope to do those once, you know, COVID does subside again.
And I do remember you coming and doing that at our church several mm-hmm. years ago, and you were pretty much there. I mean, you were right there with everybody for every meal and every conversation. And
it's about the people. I mean, when God opens a door, you don't go through it and say, you know, I need people to protect me from the people.
Yeah.
You say, okay, how can I love on you today? How can I serve you? Yeah. How can I pray for you? And that's kind of where, how I've always done it. And it's probably why I'm not like, you know, super famous and out there doing it all. But I like the smaller groups. That's just my jam.
Well, you are famous in a lot of people's eyes and mine, and people of faith who watch Survivor are going to remember you long after that series, if it ever ends, long after it's gone. But we're going to stay on for a moment or so, Leslie, and you and I are going to chat a moment after we go off and kind of wrap things up. But I want to thank you for being on my little show, Our Stories, His Glory. And I've got 10 sermon ideas now. I mean, you've got my lightning bolts coming down. Now I got a blog. I got to put sermons together. I would have been fine just going on with life had you not come on today and give me all these ideas. Oh. So I'm blaming that on you.
No, I love that. That's how Jesus works. That's how he works through us. I mean, it's awesome.
So what I want to do now is to again, thank you and tell folks that everybody has a story. And I say this quite often, you don't have to have been on Survivor to have a story or even a Survivor story. And as long as your story is for His glory, it's worth sharing with other people. And Leslie, I thank you again for being here, and I'll give you the last word before I sign off.
Well, I just want to say thank you for having me on. It's not only been great being able to share, I think this past year, you know, being kind of cooped up and not being able to get out and do what I know God's called me to do has been pretty difficult for me. So this was an opportunity for me to do that again. So I can't thank you enough for, I feel like I was kind of a little flickering flame, you know, and I feel like my torch has now been relit again.
Okay.
Not put out by Jeff Probst, but you know, I appreciate that because it is, I think it is important that we continue to do the things that God's called us to do, even in the world the way it is. We just got to find ways to do that creatively.
And for those of you who follow our stories, His Glory, I do write the Wacky Wednesday Wisdom about every other week, and about every other week I do Our Stories, His Glory. And if as I always say at the end, if the Lord's willing and the creek don't rise, I'll be back again soon with another edition of Our Stories, His Glory.